Hi, Sophie here. Thank you for all of your support over the years. I can't believe it's been, like, I was looking back at my channel, 3 years of making videos. And pretty early on to making videos, I started making brushes for grease pencil, many of which I still love and still use in all or most of my own art. So converting them to the new version of Blender, the new version of Grease Pencil 3, Blender 4.3 was pretty important to me. I'll link below all of these brush packs if you've... A lot of them are free to begin with. And if you have purchased them in the past, the updates will be included in that same purchase file. And I hope that you enjoy. First up, what is probably my favorite brush pack to date, my ink brushes. The big difference in now Blender 4.3 with Grease Pencil 3 is this new asset browser. And basically now brushes exist as assets within a Grease Pencil file, within a Blender file. So when you have these in your file, when you're in draw mode, you can access them in the same place here. They have the same icons and you can use them as you would any brush. These are meant to be used with a solid stroke material, so just a stroke type with a line type solid style. And don't forget, Vertex colors make these brushes especially fun. I originally released kind of two versions of these brushes because I realized that the original brushes I released weren't working that well. Basically, the only difference between those two versions was the simplify value of the stroke in the post-processing. So feel free to play around with that setting and to increase it if you want. So there are two ways to append these brushes to a new file. The first one, by going to append, going into the folder, and then into the file, and into the brushes folder of the file. My brushes start with SJ, but also now we see the cover images in this folder. If you have thumbnail display mode. So you could append them this way. They will get added to your asset browser in the unassigned category. And then another option, with any brushes that you get that you really like, that you think I'd like to have these in all of my files, if you go into Edit Preferences, into the file paths, then in this asset libraries, you can add different folders to this. So for example, if I were to add the folder that these ink brushes are found in and just add the folder itself, now Blender is going to remember that I love these brushes and they are going to show up in each new file. Once again, a new file, they are still showing up. They would show up until you went back into Edit Preferences, and with this icon you could remove the folder. Pretty much the same applies for this watercolor brush pack. There are four brushes in this case. The only difference here is that one of the brushes uses a very specific material type. This is a material that instead of a line type, it uses a dots line type just to create this sort of speckled look. So if you were to append these brushes to a new file, you would find them under SJ. You could append them. And then this brush has that material pinned to it. So it should be that when you start using it, that material will get added to your materials list. And this brush pretty much was designed for a material like this. So whereas the other brushes, they don't have anything pinned to them. And so it will use whatever your active material is. In this case, it's now this same dots material. So not quite what I want. So just keep an eye on that. With these other brushes, you may want to switch back to a material like this, which is a stroke, line type, solid style. I'll also link a bit the original videos I made talking about these brushes. I kind of explain how they're meant to be used and also some tips for using them, for example, with the watercolor brush. It is definitely nicest when you press really lightly and use a lot of layering to get sort of a watercolor look in that way. Next up, let's talk brushes, textured brushes that make use of the stroke outline feature. It was really interesting playing around with how this feature now works in Blender 4.3. It's a bit different, and so the brushes are packaged differently to accommodate that, but they still work and I still think they're really fun. So in the stroke dropdown, we have the stroke outline feature. And whereas before I would select a material for the outline, this is no longer working. And I realized that it kind of is just converting to whatever material that I have active at the time. So what happens is I can use this pencil brush with the stroke outline box checked, pick a material, and my strokes will turn into these watercolor strokes. Another really interesting thing is that now the texture fill, it actually responds to your pen pressure. That's new. In this case, the strength is low, so I can raise it and you'll already see these watercolor textures getting a bit darker. And I have pen pressure active by default for this pencil brush. So here's how this texture looks at max opacity. I would probably mostly use max strength, max opacity, no pen pressure for my textures because they were created with that in mind, but it is cool having the option now. So now that it's so much simpler and easier to switch between the different materials, I could just switch materials and I'm changing which texture I'm using. Before I would have had to go into the brush settings. So originally I had made a different brush for each texture, but now I think it makes sense to just have the different textures available in a blend file and you can toggle between them. Some reminders, this brush pack does make use of vertex colors. The blend value of all of these materials are all the way up at 1. So they are meant to work with whatever vertex color that you choose. I've also noticed some differences in how the textures show up. In previous versions of Blender, the texture fill would follow the direction in which the stroke was drawn, whereas now it's kind of just the same direction no matter how it's drawn. So that's just something to keep in mind. In the material settings, you can modify the rotation of these textures. There was also previously a feature in edit mode called Transform Fill, which I haven't found yet in Blender 4.3. Popping in here to add, thanks to this video, turns out the Transform Fill tool is still a thing. It does still exist. I am so happy about that. I would have missed it so much. In edit mode, this new gradient tool, it works on textured fill strokes as well as gradients. So in my case, I could use this. Select a stroke, and then you see as I drag, I am able to scale up this texture, rotate it, move it around. And what's cool is that I can select multiple strokes and give them all a similar transformation to their texture images. At the moment, with how the stroke outline feature is working in this new version of Blender, I've needed to modify the materials in one way because I really like drawing a stroke and being able to see the shape of my stroke. That shape is going to be what turns into the texture image after I release my pen pad. So it is very useful to see what I'm drawing. But in order to make that work with this new update, these materials now have to have a stroke checked on. Otherwise, you really don't know what sort of stroke you're making until you release your pen. And zoomed out like this, we don't really see it. But zoomed in, this stroke does show up. Here's the difference. I would definitely prefer the look without it. So my method personally for how I would make this work is I would, while I'm in the active working stage of a piece, I would keep this stroke box checked on, just so that I can make strokes and see what is happening. And then when I was ready to finalize, ready to export, I would just go through my materials list, go down the line, and just check off the box so that it's not going to render. This is especially not a huge deal for me personally because, like I've talked about in other videos, I have dozens to like 100 textures that I use, but not for every single piece. I really like the idea of combining a couple different textures for an artwork, like maybe max 10. I really like that it makes the art process of each piece feel a little different, feel a little bit unique. And so for that reason, adding these brushes, I likely personally wouldn't go the route of adding the entire folder as an asset library. I like to take it much more case by case, piece by piece, using the append feature to go into specific blend files. In this case, it's the material folder that you'd want to look through. I really like that now in the blend file, we actually see the icons. I think it makes it a lot easier to see which ones that I want to add and potentially use. Once a new material is added to my file, I could also add it to my materials list, use the brush that I want to use, make sure the outline feature is enabled, and create the kinds of textured strokes that I want. Depending on your piece and like different sizing of stuff, you may want to modify some of the material settings. I also have a collection of watercolor materials, watercolor brushes, which make use of the same stroke outline feature. These are just different in a couple ways. The first being that the textures themselves do have color, and so the blend values for the most part are at zero. There are a couple with low blend values because I did think that having some impact of a vertex color made them nicer, made them look prettier. But in general, not having a blend value but having a colored texture instead, I think is really cool because then within the textured stroke, we get color variation that comes from the texture itself. In this case, some pink blue strokes. We can have some green blue strokes. I'll also say these watercolor textures were a bit trickier to convert. They were not designed to be so much repeating materials as they are just a single texture image. And so, with how the stroke outline feature works now, the texture showing up not based on the direction that the stroke is drawn in, but just a static direction and rotation. No matter how the stroke is drawn, that does mean that for these strokes, for a lot of directions, we don't see the texture at all. So, a bit of a caveat to these brushes to make them work in Blender 4.3 is that I have the textures all showing up basically to the top right of the stroke. And so, you're still able to get like cool textured thin lines like this, but keep in mind that you'd want the direction that you draw these strokes in to be going from top to top right. And then one last point having to do with the direction of these textures. The one set of brushes from this brush pack that I do think is a bit of a shame not having direction to them is what are meant to be like fur brushes, because these are meant to be textures that kind of capture fur strokes. And so if they're not in the right direction, that doesn't really work. So just for this set of brushes within this larger brush pack, I've treated it like these original ink stamp textures. So these are textures where the texture is inserted into the stroke. There's no fill being used at all. So these textures can be added to a file by append, go into the folder, into the blend file, and then these are all materials. So into this material folder, and you can see the icon showing exactly what the texture looks like. Add it to your material list. And then to be able to control the rotation of these textures, I've also included in these files in the brushes folder these two brushes made to be used with all of my stamp brushes. So the way that the stamp random brush randomizes the rotation of the texture image is by randomizing the rotation so that as you press, you'll get different rotations of this texture. They seem to mostly go in a single direction, so I'd recommend the other brush. But this one is really useful if all you have is a mouse. So if I were using this brush and I had a very specific rotation that I wanted to get, I would just press and undo until I got the rotation that I was seeking. But the stamp direction, which again does require a stylus, is set up so that you can draw a stroke. You can kind of draw a straight line and the texture will follow the direction of the line that you draw. I hope that it's easy enough to use. This uses a very specific strength pressure curve. And so the idea is that you'll press hard at the start, make a stroke, and then as the stroke is being released, you're pressing a lot lighter. Because actually there are two points being created with this brush. But because of this silly strength slider, this first one is showing up with absolutely zero opacity. And what's actually cool in edit mode, if you use point select mode, you can select the second point, and moving it in 3D space is a really easy way to rotate these textures. So thank you for watching. I know grease pencil sometimes requires a bit of silliness to get things like textures to work. I personally really enjoy using it, but I can also recognize that this sort of approach and workflow may not be for everyone. That's totally fine. I really try to be honest and upfront about how my brushes work and how to make them work. I will still choose grease pencil every time, and I think there's something fun about the challenge of getting these sorts of looks, styles, and textures to work with it. If you're interested in more of my experiments, getting sort of a painterly art style with grease pencil, this playlist captures all of those videos. But what I also really like is that once you're working in Blender, you have access to all of the other tools within Blender, including stuff like geometry nodes, I don't know, video editing, compositing. There's so much cool stuff to combine with grease pencil, which is definitely one of my big motivators for using it. And so if you're interested in seeing kind of my journey learning some of these other features of this program, I also have a playlist learning geometry nodes. All right, thank you for watching. Thank you for your support. If at any point you bought these brushes, or if you plan on getting some in the future, trying them out. Like I said, a lot of them are free. I'm mostly just sharing what I personally use and what I love. And I hope that you love them as well, or at the very least that you have a good time following me along on my wacky, weird grease pencil experiments and journey. I'll see you soon. Bye.